So welcome everybody to this seminar in the series of the GRETA seminars on graph transformation system and related concepts. It is a pleasure for me to introduce today Reiko Heckel, that is doesn't need any presentation. He's, as you know, is one of the co-organizers of this series of seminar. And he's basically one of the leader of the community of graph transformation systems. Let me just tell you a couple of anecdotes. So Reiko had a PhD in Technical University of Berlin with Hartmut Ehring, completing it in 1998. Then he moved to Paderborn, where he spent some years, and finally to Leicester in 2004, okay, where he's still now. And I met Reiko the first time when he was working at the thesis, when he was a PhD student. And so this was after I left Berlin, where I visited Hartmut Ehring in 91-92. And Hartmut put me in contact with this new brilliant student interested in graph transformation system. And indeed, one of the first papers by Reiko was co-authored by me and by me, and then another one by me and Hartmut. And browsing the DBLP, I'm very happy to see that actually this cooperation with him continued along the years, because I think I'm the number one in the list of co-authors of Reiko for the number of joint publication. So just to say that I know him very well, and he gave along the years the very, very important contribution to the theory, obviously not only of graph transformation systems, their semantics, their concurrent semantics, but also on the area more close to software engineering, like model transformation, re-engineering and testing, and semantics of modeling languages, and also on variation, a contribution on variation of graph transformation system with times and with probabilities, a stochastical graph transformation system. So he gave a lot of contribution in this field. And the talk of today is based by the book that Reiko published recently, in a joint book with Gabi Tanzer, that I've seen in the audience. Hi, Gabi. Where the concepts of graph transformation are presented in an informal but precise way, and with motivations, the concept, and also applications in the realm, I imagine, mainly of software engineering, but not only. And so the talk is based on this book, and I leave the spot to Reiko, and please, Reiko.
Yeah, thank you very much, Andrea.
I want to add, if you have any question, you can either raise your hand or stop the simply speak, or write in the chat, and I will check if it is the opportunity to stop Reiko to ask the question, if it is urgent, or otherwise we can discuss this at the end. Remember that after the end of the formal talk, after 1 hour, the meeting will go on, not anymore on YouTube. We will stop the streaming and we'll continue for more informal questions or discussions with Reiko.
Yep. All right, thank you very much, Andrea. So as Andrea said, so I'm one of the organizers of the series, so I finally managed to invite myself to this to the seminar series. The reason was that we were sort of trying to open up and sort of attract a few more people who are not maybe currently in the core community, and we thought it was a good idea for them to get a bit of a sort of gentle introduction into the concepts, because most of the talks that we had in this seminar are quite specific, quite technical. So a bit of a general intro we thought was appropriate. And as Andrea said, this is joint work with Gabi, and it's a tutorial we gave before, or based on a tutorial we gave before at the models conference, which I basically split in half. So I'm going to talk about the first half mostly, and we leave the second half to a later talk by Gabi, still to be scheduled. Yeah, but we can follow this up, talking more about the application. So we'll not talk about very specific applications here. I will identify basically types of applications in order to give you an intuition about what you can do with these concepts. Okay, so let's make a start. If you talk about graphs and graph transformation, the first thing you need to understand is that graphs can represent a lot of different things. Okay, and if you just look at software engineering in particular, you can think of class structures or class diagrams as graphs, or object structures, so the objects on a heap in an object or in the program at runtime form a graph, processes, software architectures, different types of diagrams. We had talks here in the seminar on 3D objects and representing them as graphs. So all of these can be shown as graphs or represented as graphs mathematically on the one hand, but also graphs present or provide a visual representation of these things and a direct representation that is often more direct, more intuitive than, for example, a textual representation. Okay, so that's why graphs are attractive in general, as both as visualizations and as data structures. And then if you look at the different types of graphs or the different things that graphs can represent, you can think, okay, so what can you then do with graph transformation? So what does it mean then to transform these graphs, to change these graphs? And for example, if you think about object structures, then changing object structures will occur in when you run a program. So if you model the behavior of an object on the program, you see the object graph changing. Yeah, or you see a class diagram changing or a class structure changing when you manipulate programs, when you do refactoring, for example. Yeah, so there are as many reasons why you want to transform graphs as there are different types of graphs and things that these graphs represent. And so what we're seeing today here is by no means exclusive. So we will see two examples essentially, but they are by no means covering all of the different things that you could do or that you wanted to do with graphs. So we will first talk about foundations, not mathematical foundations in strictly speaking, but conceptual foundations. So what are the main concepts? And we will identify two types of applications rather than really going into the applications themselves. And I call the first one graph transformation-based software engineering. So this is basically software engineering using graph transformation. Okay, so we have a software system and we model that software system using graph transformation rules. And the second type of application is what we call graph transformation-based language engineering. So this is at the meta level. So if your graph represents models, for example, then these models will be expressed in a modeling language, and the languages themselves also have engineering aspects that we need to cover. So, for example, you have translations between different languages, you have syntax checkers for languages, and so on. Yeah. So this is language engineering, and we see simple examples of both of these. Okay. So let's make a start with the foundations then. So you see lots of different illustrations here representing different kinds of graphs. Let's see if we can recognize them. So there's a chemical molecule here in the top left that can be represented as a graph. Beside it is the Euler graph, which is basically the start of graph theory, where Euler went across the bridges in Königsberg and tried to figure out if he could walk across them without having to go over the same bridge twice or something like that. You see a subway map, what is called a food web. So basically saying a graph which has nodes, animals as nodes, or species as nodes, and relations between them, saying which animal or which species eats which other species. You can see in the bottom left here a class diagram or an object diagram rather, and a data structure represented as graphs. And then you have a graph representing some users and their computers and connections between them and so on. So I don't want to go through all of them. But you see that there are lots of different things that can be represented as graphs. And what I'm going to explain to you in the following essentially applies to all of these in different ways, depending on what you want to do with your transformations. But before we come to transformations, in order to understand or to be able to model all of those different types of graphs, there is basically a whole zoo of sort of variants of graphs. Okay. So if you have a graph basically consists of nodes and edges. Okay. But then you can ask whether you have whether edges, for example, have their own identity. So you can have two parallel edges between the same nodes, or whether edges are only a relation between nodes. Okay. So that gives rise to simple or multiple edges in graphs. There are hypergraphs where edges have more than two source or target nodes. There are directed or undirected graphs. And then graphs may be decorated by labels or attributes. So you can put data on there. You can have types and you can express constraints and things like that. So what we've done here is we defined what is called a feature model. And the feature model basically describes all the different variants of graphs that we could think of. Yeah. So every instance of this feature model describes one particular graph variant. So this is in the book. I'm not going to sort of explain that in any more detail, but I'm going to show you a couple of examples. So if you look at this, one of the example graphs that I showed earlier, so we have three users here, Peter, Gabi, and Reiko, and they are connected by these edges. Then you can represent that, for example, as an undirected labeled graph. So undirected means that the edges don't have a direction here, so there's no arrow no arrowhead on either end, and labeled because the nodes here are labeled by these names, Peter, Gabi, and Reiko. Okay, and the way to do that, I mean, you see the sort of simple mathematical formulation here for yourself. Essentially, what that means for the actual definition of what such a graph represents. So this is one example. If you want another example, which is closer to what we actually want to do in the future here, we use directed typed graphs. So directed graph means that edges have direction, so they have an arrow at the end. And typed means that we don't just represent one graph representing one data set or one state or one configuration, but we first of all represent or model the types that can be used in this graph, and therefore somehow the set of all possible graphs that we can represent. Okay, so for that we have a type graph, which is the thing that you see in the top, in the bottom right here, and this says that we have three types: user, client, and super, that are linked by certain types of edges here. Okay, so this is like a class diagram essentially, without methods and attributes at this stage. And then you have an instance of that, which is this graph G. And there you see that there are two clients here, C1 and C2, pointing to users, Peter and Reiko. And then there's another super user here, super node, which points to user Gabi, and they are all linked. So the clients are linked to the super node. Okay. So this G here is an instance of this type graph TG. Okay. So this is another variant of graph. And because I introduced this distinction earlier between graph transformation based software engineering and graph transformation based language engineering, so this is an example. It's not much yet, but it's going to be an example of graph transformation based software engineering. So I'm describing here not a language, yeah, but a particular application. Namely, this is going to be a peer-to-peer application. Think of Skype or something of that sort. Okay, so a peer-to-peer application where users can communicate with each other. Okay. Right. So to show an example of the other type, of the language engineering type, I chose a little sort of diagram language here that some of you are hopefully familiar with, but if not, it's not a big problem. So these are Petri nets. So Petri nets are essentially flow diagrams, you could say, maybe the mother of all flow diagrams, in the sense that they sort of have all the sort of the really basic concepts like transitions and states. And as you can see here, states can be marked, so they can have tokens on them. And these tokens are changed when or moved from one place to another if the transition fires. And the nice thing about Petri nets is that you can have tokens in more than one place at the same time. So it's basically like a flow diagram where the state is distributed. Yeah? So you can be in multiple states at the same time. So they're very good, very useful and simple modeling tools, and are also used as semantics for other modeling languages like business process diagrams, for example. So our exercise here is to first of all create a type graph for these. So imagine we want to model first of all the language of all Petri nets. So we need to first of all understand what the type graph would look like, and then how a concrete Petri net would look like that is an instance of that type graph. Yeah? So how do we represent this as a graph? Okay, and there are different ways of doing this. So let me just go through at least two options here. So what you see here is a type graph that says there is a type of node for places, there is a type of node for transitions. Okay, so P and T, and then there is the edges that tell each transition what are the pre and post places. Yeah, so the pre places are the ones obviously left of the transition, and the post places are the ones right of the transition, or where the arrow points to, or and where the arrow comes from. And then we have another type of node here, Tn, and that represents the tokens, the little black dots that sit on the places. Okay, so these are all nodes, and they are connected in a suitable way, and then we hope that we can represent a Petri net in that way. Okay, so that is one of the options. Another option is to not have tokens as separate nodes, because maybe we are not interested in the identity of the tokens as nodes, we are just interested in how many they are. So in that case, we come to a type graph here, which has attributes inside. So you can see here that there is an attribute in the type P, in the node type P of an attribute M of type nut, so it's a natural number. Okay, and that means that, we basically have a counter in each of these places, okay, rather than having a set of tokens associated with it. Yeah, so these are both models that represent Petri nets in a meaningful way, even if they are different. And if you're interested then in understanding how a concrete Petri net would be modeled based on this type graph, so let's take the second one because it's a bit more concise. You see that the little Petri net that we see in the top right there basically has two transitions, T0, T1, and T3. Okay, and between T0 and T1 there is a place, and between T1 and T2 there is a place. And you see this Petri net in a particular state here because it's the state where both places have exactly one token on it. Yeah, M stands for marking, so have exactly one token for it. Yeah, so it's round about, I don't know whether it's round about now, I think, if we wait for the right point in the cycle. So you can see that we can represent the set of all Petri nets in that way, and we can represent a particular Petri nets as an instance graph. Okay, and if we reflect a little bit on the design decisions that we took here, So what we did was we represented the PetriNet as a what is called a bipartite graph, essentially. So a graph that has two different types of nodes and edges only between nodes of different types. One could have used a hypergraph instead, an unordered hypergraph, which would have meant that we consider transitions as edges rather than as nodes. But we didn't do that. This model is a bit more mainstream, I suppose, a bit simpler potentially. I already discussed the fact that we can represent the number of tokens either by having individual tokens as nodes or by having just the counter for the number of tokens. And we went for the second choice here because it's a bit more abstract, a bit simpler. And for future reference, what you see here in the top and also the concrete example, the graph here in the bottom right, is what is called a marked graph. So a marked graph is a PetriNet that only has where all transitions only have exactly one place in the pre-domain and in the post-domain. Okay, so like the example here, yeah, rather than having up to one, sorry, not exactly one, up to one. So rather than having several, yeah? But in general, a transition could have several places in the pre and the post. Okay, so that brings us to attributed graphs. So we saw already that you can put numerical attributes in graphs, okay, and that we can represent them in type graphs as well. So our peer-to-peer model here can make use of that as well. So if you look at this type graph in the bottom here, you see that a supernode now has an integer attribute counting the number of clients, and the user has actually a string attribute for a name. And otherwise, we can represent essentially the same graph, the same situation as we had before in G here. But you can see now that the supernode here has a client counter of 2, and the names that were sort of represented as object IDs before are now attributes, which is the proper way of doing this, because an object ID is really an internal thing which doesn't really represent any data. Okay, so you can see an attributed graph in action here. The other thing that I've done here is to introduce subtyping. So I said that supernodes and super and client are both nodes. Okay, so you see the subtyping, the inheritance relation here between node and super and client. And that means that I can link both of them to users using user edges without having to duplicate that information in the type graph by attaching the user type to both client and then super. Okay, so like you would normally do in object-oriented design, you want to avoid such kinds of duplication. Right, so that's all I wanted to say about this, I think. So again, this is an example of graph transformation based software engineering. So what I'm modeling here again is a system, an application, if you like, and not a language as in the previous case. Okay. Right, so that's all I wanted to say about graphs. Okay, so now let's come to the more exciting things to do with rules and transformations, because this is what we're actually about here. So transformations are just changes of graphs in principle. So you can look at this little example here and see we have the graph that we started with previously with Gabi, Peter, and Reiko sort of happily connected here. And then we drop the link between Gabi and Reiko, okay? So if both of these states before and after this change can be represented as graphs. And then this change, this deletion of this link is a very simple example of a graph transformation. Okay. And both of these instance graphs or state graphs are typed over the type graph that you see in the bottom right here. So it's basically a pictorial representation of the kind of information we had in this more formal object graph earlier. Okay, so this is a transformation, but now we want to describe transformations in a general way, in a rule-based way. Okay, so the rule should describe what has changed. Okay, so what has changed in this case is that the link was deleted, but it should also describe in which situations that can happen. Okay, and let's have a look at that. So the rule is now what you see in the top here, and the rule, if you look at it, abstracts from the fact that the two users involved in the transformation are Gabi and Reiko. Yeah, so it just has variables for them, U1 and U2. And all you see here is that in this particular case, user U2 has a laptop and user U1 has a desktop, so that we keep that information. So the idea is that we only want to delete the link in that particular situation, and that after the application of the rule, the two are not linked anymore. Okay, so imagine the desktop to represent a super node and the laptop to represent a client node, and this is consistent with the representation in the previous picture, in the previous sort of graph representation. And the idea is that we can unlink a client from a super node. Okay, that's basically what the rule says. Yeah, so we don't care about Peter in the rule, and we don't care what the users are called that we connect or disconnect here, or how many users the super node is connected to, for that matter. Yeah, so in that sense, the rule is more abstract than the transformation. So if we have a rule, then we can look at this by itself and say, so what does this rule actually tell us to do? And it tells us, first of all, that certain things are deleted, namely everything that is in the left-hand side, which is the top left graph here, but not in the right-hand side, which is the top right graph, that should be deleted. Dually, everything that is in the right-hand side, but not the left-hand side, is created, but there isn't any, that doesn't happen here, so there isn't anything created here in this particular example. But it also shows us then, as I said, what is the context for the application, namely, this only happens if, we have particular types of nodes and if they are connected to particular users here. Okay, and this context is preserved, so this context is not changed. That is just part of the conditions under which the rule is applied, rather than being part of the actual change. So this is what a basic rule can describe. And sort of traditionally, there are two different ways of describing that formally, mathematically. One is called summarized under gluing approaches, and the other on as connecting approaches. The idea is essentially, or the question here is, how to connect the new things that you have in a graph that you want to add to a graph to the stuff that is already there. So the deletion isn't usually a problem, yeah, because we heard that we delete everything that is in the left-hand side, but not in the right-hand side. So we just delete that in the graph. And that gives us, sort of in both of these cases, a graph, let's say if L is the bit that is deleted, the red part here, that gives us a graph that looks like the previous one, except that it doesn't have that part anymore that was deleted. Yeah? And that is the same in both of these cases. But then the gluing approach assumes that whatever isn't created, so let's say that is R here in the top case in the gluing approaches, that whatever is created there is connected to the rest of the graph by means of the context, which is the dark blue area that is preserved by the rule. Okay, so this is what we will see in a moment. Whereas in the connecting approaches, you don't have that context. You just have basically a disjoint union of the rest of the graph that you get after deletion and the right-hand side, and then you need to figure out how to make connections between them, yeah, because you need to link the graph to the rest somehow. So let's have a look at how this works in the connecting approach. So if you take a rule here that just creates a new node, okay? So it creates a new user here connected to or with a sort of with a supernode. So this is basically a rule for creating a supernode. But then you want to say that you connect this supernode to all of the other supernodes that you already have in the system. Okay, so create a new node and connect it to all other supernodes. Okay, so if you apply that now to a graph, as you see in the bottom left, then we have two supernodes, Gabi and Barbara here. And after the transformation, we have the new supernode here, okay, and it's connected to Gabi and Barbara. Okay, so what you see here is that there's a kind of universal quantification, universal statement saying connect this new node to all the supernodes. Yeah? And that is what makes this powerful, but also sort of harder from a mathematical point of view, or from an algorithmic point of view, than the gluing approach, which just says, oh, insert this new thing here where I show it should be inserted in the rule. Okay. So it's a good feature to have. And therefore, some of the gluing approaches also use a trick to achieve the same using so-called multi-objects, which we'll probably see in a few minutes if we find the time to do that. Okay, so this is the very basic idea. Okay, so this is really basic rules. So if you look at the feature model here again, overall the concept of graph transformation, and then you have the basic approach on the left, that is an alternative choice here between embedding or gluing. And then there are lots of different additional things that rules can contain, because usually if you start modeling concrete problems, then you find that the very basic rule-based approach is not expressive enough for many of these problems. So sort of transformation rules can have different types of actions, like deleting, sort of adding, copying, and merging nodes and edges, in addition to creating things. You have application conditions, which we'll see. I mentioned multi-objects or multi-patterns is a sort of more advanced form of that. And we'll have rules that basically look like implementations or specifications of operations with parameters and return types. So something like a declaration of an operation, as you would see in a sort of object-oriented programming language, for example. You also have you can also do for a rule, and sort of many other things that I'm not going to into now, but we'll sort of maybe touch upon a little bit. So we've seen this informal representation of rules. So here's the more formal representation of a rule to terminate a client, to end a client. So the client is basically part of is the application that the user uses in order to as I said, maybe make phone calls, if you think of a Skype client application, for example. So what you see is that you can apply this operation if you have a client, of course, C, and that client is linked to a user and is linked to a supernode. So the supernode is like a server, like a node that plays a server role, even if it's a peer-to-peer network. But there are more important nodes and less important nodes in this peer-to-peer network, and the supernodes are the important nodes that provide the services to the clients. And because we want to keep track of the number of clients, we also know that the attribute, the client counter of this supernode is n. Okay, and then if you apply this rule, you see that afterwards the client is gone, the user is still there. Obviously, the edges linking the client are also gone. And the attribute, the client counter of the supernode, is counted down by one. Okay, so hopefully not too surprising. So just to point out, we use an object-oriented notation here. So these are like objects in an object diagram. We have attributes conditions, like clients equal n is an attribute condition, and we have attribute assignments, okay, like clients colon equals is an assignment. And we also see the rule signature here. Well, we don't see the rule signature in the rule, it just has a rule label which says that end client of C equals C. So this is basically this declares C to be the return type or the return value for this operation. And we have a rule signature which says that this has C as an input and the client as an output type. Okay. So that's the rule as such. So this is like a program. Okay. And now we want to see what happens if we actually, or like, let's say a method. This is like a method. Okay. And now we want to see what happens if we actually call the method in a particular state with particular objects in our runtime environment. Okay. So we take the graph again that we had previously representing the runtime objects. And now the question is what should happen? Okay. So I described abstractly what should happen. But now concretely, we have to say which of the elements in the in graph here should be deleted, what should be created, if anything, and what attribute values should be changed. And if you think about this a little bit, you notice that we don't quite know yet, because it doesn't say here, at least in this picture at the moment, the client C here, which client this actually refers to. Yeah. So essentially, you could say we are missing the parameters, the actual parameters of the method invocation. So we don't know if C equals C1 or if C equals C2. But if we decide that C equals C2, yeah, so as you can see in the arrow here in the bottom, then you'll see that the effect will be that, well, C2 will be deleted. As we said earlier, the links will be deleted and the client counter goes down by one. Okay, so we need information about the rule we apply. So, as in the case of a method invocation, we need to know which method to use, but we also need the parameters. Yeah? And in the case of the of graph transformation, the parameters are determined by what we call a match. So a match is an embedding of the left-hand side into the input graph by means of what we technically call a graph morphism, or you can think of this as a subgraph isomorphism, or it's basically effectively the left-hand side is a subgraph modulo renaming of the input graph. And we have to determine basically where that match is in order to be able to say what the result of the transformation is. Okay, so that's the basic mechanism for applying rules. So if you look at an example again at the PetroNet example again and see if we can create a few rules here for this, the first thing that we may want to do is to just create a set of rules that generate all possible mark graphs. So to recall, mark graphs are essentially simple PetriNets. So PetriNets that look like the one that we see here, rather than having sort of branching and joining edges on the transitions. Okay, so how do we create these simple graphs? Well, it's not particularly difficult. You just create all the places. Okay, so we have one rule that says I can make a new place. Yeah, and I give it a parameter k to initialize the counter, the token counter. So that means I can create a new place with a particular number of tokens on it. Okay, so I hope that's clear from the notation here. We basically start with the rule basically has an empty graph on the left hand side here, and on the right hand side it has a graph consisting of one node only. Yeah, so that means we can apply this everywhere. This rule, we don't need any matching. We don't need to determine any input parameters in this case except for the k. Because we can create places freely. And then we have the second rule, which creates a new transition. So it basically assumes that there are already two places, P1 and P2. And if we have those two places, we create a new transitions between transition between them and point it to the pre and the post place. Okay, so we create a node and two edges in this particular case. So I hope that's clear enough. You could argue that this is not really very good yet, because you end up with places that have isolated nodes, with nets that have isolated nodes, isolated places, sorry. But one could, if we wanted to, we could rule that out by having additional constraints, for example, saying that nodes cannot be isolated. But otherwise, this is so good enough. So the idea is now that we start with an empty graph, and then we the set of all possible Mark graphs, the set of all possible simple Petri nets here, can be generated by applying these two rules in lots of different places, in lots of different orders. Okay. So this is what is called a grammar, and in this particular case, you would call it a graph grammar, okay? Because it generates a language. So that's one thing that we may want to do here. So specifying the language that we want to work with. The other thing that is useful here is to specify the operational semantics of the language. So how does this language work? What does it do? Okay? Because clearly you see the PetriNet here is moving. So it's changing its state. So we want to model how that works. Okay, and this is a bit more complicated. So if you look at the rule at the bottom here, we see that you start with you have a transition here, and the transition, the pre place of the transition has a mark of k, which should be greater than zero. Okay, and the post state, the post place, sorry, has a mark of l. So they have certain numbers of token on it, and the first one is greater than zero. And then in order to fire the transition, you take one token away from the pre-place and put one token onto the post-place. Okay, so all that changes here are really the attributes of the places. Everything else remains the same. So it's, from that point of view, not very interesting as a graph transformation, because it's only changing the attributes, but it describes the firing of the transition. Which, if you look at the picture here, is basically when the transition goes red and changes the tokens in the before and after states. So we have two things here. We have, on the one hand, the specification of the language of marked graphs, so of simple PetriNets, and we have specified how they work. So basically, the execution behavior of these nets. Okay, with three simple rules, which isn't too bad. It's a simple example, but still, if you can fit it on one slide, it's not too bad. Again, some more interesting rules in the peer-to-peer model. Essentially, here the idea is, as I said, that we have what is called a structured peer-to-peer network. So we have supernodes and simple nodes or client nodes. And the supernodes basically form kind of servers for the client nodes. And what you see here are lots of rules for basically building up the network, creating supernodes, creating client nodes, linking clients to supernodes. So these are the first three. Mostly similar to what we saw already, the other interesting feature here is that we use what are called negative application conditions. So the red parts here, that are also crossed out, like the red node that is crossed out with the red crossed out user edge, they signify that, or this particular negative application condition signifies that this particular user doesn't have a node pointed to it already. Yeah, so we basically say, in order to apply the rule, we need a user and the super node. But the user cannot be the target of a user edge from any node yet. Okay. And if you recall the type graph that we saw earlier, a node can be either a super node or a client node. It basically says that this user isn't currently connected to an application, to either a super or a basic version of this Skype application, let's say. Okay. So if that's the case, then we create a new supernode, link it to the user, and then also link it to an existing supernode, because we don't want the supernodes to be isolated. Okay, so it should be connected between each other. Similarly, we can create a client node for a user. Okay, if there isn't any node yet supporting that user or using that, serving that user. And in the third rule, you see how clients can be linked to supernodes, etc. So I hope that makes sense. It goes on. So it's kind of interesting, because you can promote clients. So you say you have a basic application, but if you need more supernodes, more nodes also playing server roles, then you can promote clients to supernodes and so on. But I probably don't have time to go through that in any detail. It's all described in detail in the book. But so these are all the rules that create things, essentially, that build up our peer-to-peer network. And then dually you have rules that sort of break it down again, that deconstruct it again. Yeah. So you disconnect nodes and you terminate nodes. So without going through all of these individually, I hope this is reasonably clear that you can do that. And yeah, the devil is in the detail as usual, but I hope we got it right here. But sort of moving on, there are some more advanced things that we may want to do. So if you just look at supernodes, the idea is that the supernodes are basically what connects the network. So clients are always connected to supernodes, and the supernodes should be connected between themselves. So an interesting property of such a network is that you don't lose connectivity. Yeah, or you shouldn't lose connectivity, because if you lose connectivity, so let's say if you have two supernodes that are not connected anymore, that means that the clients of one supernode cannot talk to the clients of the other supernode anymore, because they don't have a connection. Yeah, so you want redundancy in the network, okay? And that redundancy can be introduced by just sort of introducing shortcuts, like you can see here. So we have three supernodes here on the left that are connected in this way. And then you just make a triangular connection here that connects S1, S2 and S3 directly. So now if supernode S1 decides to leave, okay, because someone shuts down their desktop computer, then S2 and S3 can still talk to each other. Okay, so that's the idea. The question is now, if you look at this, what can go wrong? So is this perfect, or is there something here that can have unexpected results if you apply this rule? And I wouldn't talk about this for 2 minutes if there wasn't something. So if you take, for example, a match now where S2 and S3 match to the same node in the input graph, that would cause a loop to be created. Yeah. So if S2 and S3 are the same node here, yeah, or match to the same node in the input graph, then this overlay edge here would be a loop, and that would not really make a lot of sense. Yeah, because it would seem like this node would be talking to itself. Okay, so that means that we may impose certain conditions on the matches in order to prevent sort of unexpected or unwanted results. And in this particular case, the technical term is injective matches. So injective means that if there are two different things in the rule, then they're also different in the graph, okay? Which maybe is the thing that you expect in most cases intuitively. If matches are not injective, so if you're allowed to identify, have two things in the rule that are matched to the same thing in the graph, there are sort of other slightly obscure but also interesting things that can happen. So for example, in this case here on the left, you see that AR1 and AR2 are both mapped to AG, okay? And if you look at the right-hand side of that rule, it says that AR1 is preserved, so that node we keep, but AR2 is deleted, okay? And now we have a problem, because this rule effectively tells us delete AR2 and preserve AR1, so we don't know what to do with AG now. Yeah? And equally, on the other side, we see that AR1 and AR2 are both mapped to AG, and both are deleted. Um, so, So again, you could argue that this is kind of strange, because if AR1 and AR2 somehow represent things that actually have value, let's say, represent resources. So let's say I need £2 to buy me a beer, and if I if it turns out that these £2 are the same pound, somehow that doesn't work. Okay, so I need them to be separate. And in order to ensure that, in these particular situations where we delete things, we can have additional conditions that prevent funny things from happening. But even so, this the actual operations here are well defined. So there are formalisms that allow us to do that, formalizations of graph rewriting that allow us to do this. So the particular term here is a single push out approach, if you come across this, or sesqui push out, or other sort of variants like this. So in this case, it always says that deletion has preference. So if you have a situation where one says delete and the other says preserve, then you delete. And equally, if both say delete, then you also delete. Sorry, I was telling lies. So sesqui pushout approach doesn't allow this sort of thing, as far as I'm aware. So this is exactly what it doesn't allow, to have these kinds of conflicts, as we call them here, and identification of deleted things. So, but in general, there is, as I said, there is a condition that condition that we can impose on all matches that prevent these two things from happening, so that these kind of strange or potentially unwanted effects don't occur. Yeah, and this is called the identification condition. So similar but even more useful thing to understand, I think, is the question of what I call deletion in unknown contexts. So if you look at this situation here, we delete the supernode. Using this end super rule, it could be that the supernode is still connected to other supernodes. Okay. So what happens to the other supernodes? So what happens to these connections? And again, there are two possible answers. One is, if the supernode has connections to other supernodes that we don't see in the rule and that we don't delete explicitly, then we are not allowed to delete it. So that would be what I would call a conservative approach. So we are only deleting exactly what we see, what the rule tells us to delete. And if there's any implicit deletion, in databases, they call that cascading delete sometimes, we don't allow that. Okay, so that is the strict approach, and that would in a sense not allow us to apply that rule. The alternative is to allow that and just basically apply this cascading deletion. So if we have a dependent edge that we cannot have anymore because we delete the source or a target of it, then we also delete that edge. Yeah, and this is so I should have said here, so this is basically what approaches like sort of formalizations of graph rewriting, such as single push out or sesqui push out, allow us to do. Whereas the left variant here with the dangling condition is what is implemented by what is called the double push out approach, which, for reasons that I'm not going into, is basically more restrictive and more conservative here. Okay. Otherwise, there are just two different ways, or maybe more than two, but a number of different ways of mathematically describing the kind of behavior, which have different properties and different sort of theoretical results as well. So you can essentially choose your level of expressivity, and then you can see, in a sense, what theory still holds in this particular case. So we try to map this out a little bit by listing all the different general application conditions that we could think of, and sort of ordered them by conservative versus radical, Again, I mean, if you want to have the details on this, it's all sort of defined in the book. There are a few advanced features of rules which one can talk about. So, or for graphs in general and rules. So we can express constraints over graphs, which is not that unusual. I mean, in object-oriented modeling, you have the OCL, the object constraint language, for example, that can be used to represent constraints like the one I show you in the logical representation. So you can say the client attribute is zero if and only if the set of nodes you can get by navigating along the link edge is empty. So that would be an OCL constraint, but you can express that also graphically in the way I show here in the bottom. You say the left graph here is forbidden. Basically, you cannot have a zero client counter and a client, and the right graph is forbidden as well. You cannot have a greater than zero client counter and no client. Okay, so that's basically the equivalent representation of that constraint. And this is very useful because often, I mean, the type graph can be used to represent the set of all instance graphs that you are sort of able to allow. But often this is not enough. Often you need additional constraints, especially on the attributes. Another example here is negative application conditions. I mentioned those already, but this is a particularly interesting one, slightly more complicated one, which says we can apply the shortcut rule only if the two nodes that we want to connect are not connected already, either directly or indirectly. Okay, so that allows us to create redundancy where we need it rather than just sort of creating a complete graph here, for example. There are also sort of further advanced features. I mentioned multi-objects already. So multi-objects are basically universally quantified actions. In this particular case, we can say we want to we want to delete all the edges connecting a supernode that we are deleting to any other supernode. So it's universally quantified over all the other supernodes that this supernode is connected to. Okay, and you see an example here of how this is applied. So we delete the supernode. We delete the supernode S, and this is connected to two other supernodes S1 and S2. And the fact that we delete the edges to these supernodes is captured by the fact that we have this multi-object S, uppercase S, in the rule here in the middle. Okay. Finally, there is a way to integrate the left-hand side and the right-hand side of the rule. This is just a shorter representation because often the difference between the left and the right-hand side isn't very big. So rather than separating these out, we can merge them together. And that means that that we can basically save a bit of space, make it all represented in one graph. But then we need to say within that rule graph, what are the nodes and edges that are created, what are the nodes and edges that are deleted, and what are the nodes and edges that are part of a negative application condition. And we do that by colors, essentially, by colors and labels. Yeah. So I hope that's clear. We're close to the end, Andreas, isn't it? I'm trying to be on time, even if there's a lot more that I could cover. So let's come back to that nice pattern example here. So I said that we had defined the operational semantics for these simple patternets, for these marked graphs, okay, where every transition only has one input and one output place. So now if you wanted to define this for general patternets where transitions can have more than one input and output place, for example, we could say, we have a separate rule for every, if you like, cardinality. So for every situation where a transition has sort of a certain number of input places and a certain number of output places, we need a separate rule. Okay, and what you see here is the case for two input places and one output place. Okay, so both input places need to have tokens on them, and then we take these off and add one token to the output place. So in order to ensure that this is only applicable to transitions of exactly that cardinality, so with exactly one two input and one output place, we can add negative application conditions. So we can say there are no further input places and no further output places. So then that rule would match exactly the situations that we want. So that is good. The problem is still that we need a separate rule for every different sort of number of input and output places, okay, which isn't very nice because, well, potentially there could be infinitely many. Well, there are not infinitely many input and output places, but these would be infinitely many rules unless we limit the number of transitions. The degree of the structure somehow. So this is another application of these multi-rules or multi-objects. So here we can say we take all the input places collectively as a multi-object, and all the output places collectively also as a multi-object. Okay. And then take away from the input places and add to the output places. But then we also need to ensure that the conditions are all satisfied. So this is a little bit subtle, but it boils down to the fact that this box here, this multi-object P1 in the left-hand side of the rule, basically represents the set that is defined here. So this is the set of all the P1s of all the nodes that are in the pre-domain of this transition and where the marking is greater than zero. Okay, but then we need to ensure that this is actually the entire set of the entire preset of that transition, and for that we add this additional negative application condition. Yeah. But if we put these two things together, we're able to model this general five-ring rule for the transition. Okay, so I hope that makes sense. It took me a bit to figure that out myself, so it's not entirely true, because it basically is a double negation that you need here effectively, but I hope it sort of makes sense. Right, so yeah, there was a lot more I wanted to talk about, which I don't. You can have a look at that yourself. So in the book I talk about different uses of graph transformation for different sort of representing different semantic models, and different analysis techniques related to that. As I said, this is all part of, I think we basically covered the first two chapters now. And if you look at the third and the fourth chapter, this is what I didn't talk about today. And then there is a whole list of different types of applications are also covered there. So since we talked about the difference between graph transformation-based software engineering and language engineering, chapters 5 to 9 are examples of graph transformation-based software engineering where we model systems or applications, and 10 to 12 are examples of graph transformation-based language engineering. Yeah, so you see both of these represented there, but we're not going to go into that any further because we don't have time, and Gabi promised that eventually at some point we may be able to get the second part of the tutorial, which will cover some of that. No particular commitment yet, but we'll find a convenient time at some point. There's also a tool that one can look at, which implements essentially the concepts that I introduced so far and some of the analysis techniques that I didn't introduce. But again, it's not really the time to talk about this. So yes, thank you very much for now. And that's all I wanted to say.
Thank you very much, Rajko. It was interesting to see this crystal clear introduction to informal introduction, formal but precise introduction to the basic concept of graph transformation system. Is there any question or remarks from the audience? Somebody wants to make some observation, some question? Yes, Mustafa Ghani. Can you switch on your microphone?
Yes, hello. thank you very much for this very nice talk. My name is Mustafa. I'm a PhD student from Holger Giese. So I recently joined his group. And I really like the distinction that you did. So the distinction between language engineering and software engineering within the graph area. And I have a background in PetroNets, and therefore I would like to know, to be honest, it's a bit tricky question. What would you say, what are the grand challenges in language engineering from a PetroNet perspective?
That's a good, that's a very general question. So maybe the first thing one should say is that the way in which PetroNets were represented here is not the only way to do it. Okay, so there is I would argue a more direct way, which would sort of represent a PetroNet essentially as a set of rules. So if you represent transitions as rules, then you can think of a PetroNet as a set of rules that just rewrite nodes. So a transition basically takes a bunch of nodes and deletes them and creates a new bunch of nodes. So as a type graph transformation systems, places are types, node types, transitions are rules, and the tokens are the nodes in the left and right hand side of the. So this is arguably even more basic, but that would be that would not be an example of language engineering technically, because your set of rules would describe a concrete application, a concrete system, rather than something that is universal for all the language. Yeah, but if you're interested in that, Andrea was one of the people who developed that. So we have lots of pointers on this, and a lot of the theory of graph transformation sort of arises from that connection, because we looked at PetroNet theory and then sort of tried to understand, using that way of understanding the relationship, what the corresponding theory in graph transformation would be like. So that probably doesn't answer your question, but just saying that that there are other links between PetroNets and graph transformation that are interesting. My instinct is on the PetroNet side. I mean, obviously the kind of basic PetroNets that you saw, I mean, people understand very well. So you don't win an award by modeling the operational semantics of PetroNets, yeah, because that is well established. I think the challenges are in the kind of, first of all, there are lots of different types of PetroNets. So there is variability there. There's probably variability in the semantics. So if you think you have a particular problem that you want to model, you could ask, what is the right PetroNet for that? So what features do you need? And can you then maybe generically define those and provide an operational semantics for those nets based on a particular selection of features? Yeah, so having sort of variance in there. So maybe this is one dimension. And the other dimension, I suppose, is the kind of software engineering of it, in the sense that in many cases, I think you don't want individual PetroNets just describing the entire system, but what you really want is a kind of component model on PetroNets. Yeah, and then maybe you want to you need to understand how you compose the nets, you need to understand how the composition of nets works together with the execution semantics of the nets. Maybe then you have another level where you have reconfiguration. Yeah, because the PetroNets represent components in a system where components can be exchanged or can be connected differently at runtime. So there's an interaction between maybe networks of PetroNets, if you like, and how they are reconfigured and the actual execution of the nets themselves. So
also from maybe from hierarchy perspective, probably that would be also.
And yeah, the hierarchical Petri nets, you're right. The hierarchical Petri nets where, yeah, I think they're different kinds even. In some cases you have tokens that are nets. In other cases you can, I don't know, maybe have transitions that are nets or whatever. But yeah, you're right. And then you get into systems that are probably as complicated or more complicated than the kind of basic rule-based systems that we've seen here. And you could think of the graph writing rules as a kind of meta language to describe that and manage that. Yeah, so that would be a typical language engineering problem then in that case. Yeah. There is work by, so where is she? I'll find something. I'll find some pointers.
I have four more questions. If it's allowed, I can send you an email. And if you like,
please send me an email and I'll send you some pointers to things that come to mind. I mean, there has been people working on this relation between graph transformation and Petri nets in this kind of more applied software engineering context.
All right. Great. Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. Any other question or remark? Maybe I have one, Raiko. Mm-hmm. You, with this running example of Petri nets, you have shown, besides modeling the net as a graph, the modeling using graph transformation rules of two different aspects. One is generating the settable nets, and the other one is modeling the behavior of nets.
Mm-hmm.
My question is basically if in the book you present these two aspects of using a graph transformation rule as distinguished or let's say different characteristics or simply as different examples of using them. If you, I don't know if my point is clear.
I mean, yeah, I think so. So, I mean, this applies to the language engineering domain in any case, because in the, I would argue anyway, it's because this relation between grammar and operational semantic rules is what you're asking. And I think this is really a language engineering question. So,
in fact, you have to generate the systems and then rules for modeling the behavior. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, there's more than these two. I mean, okay. So if you think about language engineering, and this is really Gabi's sort of domain, but so you have grammars, of course, describing the language. You have rules that can describe operational semantics, as we've seen, but you also have rules that describe mappings between languages, for example, so model transformations. So at least these three, and you probably have, or not probably, but you have sort of extensions of what you would consider grammar rules that you could call editing rules. So rules that basically manipulate diagrams, but not necessarily in the sense of being in an unambiguous way of generating them, but representing editor operations, yeah, which can make complex changes to the
reconfigurations.
Reconfiguration, yeah, or refactorings or things like that. But so complex operations which change the diagram. So maybe there are kind of four different obvious cases here. And there are connections between them, as you can imagine. So for example, the model transformation and the semantic rules, there is probably a connection there, or there should be a connection there, because if you do a model transformation, you would want it to respect the semantics in some way. Yes? So you can ask whether the model transformation respects the semantics. Or if you have grammar rules and model transformation rules, you can ask whether all the models that you can generate using the grammar rules can also be transformed using the model transformation rules. Yeah, so in that sense, there are sort of systematic relationships between them, and they are represented in, I can't remember exactly which chapter it is, but sort of depending on exactly which pair of, so these chapters 10, 11, and 12 basically talk about relationships, I mean, different things that you can do with rules, but then also typically there's more than one type of thing that you do, and the question how, for example, grammars relate to model transformations, or how grammars relate to, I don't know if you had anything about the relation between grammars and operational semantics, to be honest. So that is probably a question we haven't really asked, but there's certainly something about relation of operational semantics with model transformation, I'm sure, and editing operations and things like that. I don't know, Gabi, are you still there? Can you? I cannot. I have to. Maybe I should switch on my.
Yeah. I don't know if she's wanting to add something. Okay, thanks anyway for it. Very, very clear. So this is about language engineering. Okay. Any other questions? I don't see other questions. If not, I think it is a good moment to stop the streaming on YouTube, and we may continue in the private session. And before this, I would like to announce that in 2 weeks, on January 28th, on January 28th, we will have the next seminar in this series, which will be held by William Waits, about, and the title is Rule-Based Models of Epidemics. So a very hot topic, and William will show us how rule-based system can be used to model the spread of epidemics, and how this can be used to analyze also the most recent pandemic situation we have in the world. So it's an extremely interesting topic, showing an important application of graph transformation system. And this said, I would like to thank again Raiko, and we wait now that the YouTube streaming stops, and then we can continue with some more informal questions.